Martin Luther King Jr. celebration. Most of you know, the late Dr. King was a man who possessed and stood for dignity, pride, and wanted equality for all. In honoring his birthday and recognizing all of those great accomplishments, we must not forget the past struggle he endured. As a community and a nation, we must continue to persevere. Someday soon, the dream of coming together as one nation, one country, and equality will truly be a reality. I have a couple of brief announcements. For those of you that would like to mark your calendars for the year 2000, we have our guest speaker booked, confirmed, and I'm very proud to announce that we have Julian Bond. Yes. Because this event is a very special event, it's the anniversary, our 20th anniversary, it's the turn of the century, and we have our guest speaker is a national dignitary. The MLK Planning Committee has started recruiting for new committee members. We're also encouraging anyone that would like to become partnerships or become or form a partnership in order for this event to go over smoothly. Please, by all means, contact us. On behalf of the MLK Committee, I would like to express our appreciation for the support that everyone has given over the past, in the past, the future, and the present. Thank you very much.
Thank you. you once again. Have you blessed us on this occasion, another year. We ask that you look on us right now as we gather here tonight, oh God, to look on with such a great honor, oh God, a man that stood for something in the country in which you live. Oh God, we ask that you bless every heart that's here tonight. We ask that you bring us in love and in harmony. Most of all, oh God, keep us in that unity in the name of Jesus. We come and thank you tonight because you've been so good. You woke us up this morning, started us on our way. You gave us a mind to serve you, the beauty of holiness. Father, we thank you right now. We ask you to look on the singers, oh God, that travel over the dangerous highway safely. We ask you to look on the speaker hour tonight. Touch our heart right now. Oh God, we ask you to look on this committee that works so hard throughout the year to bring this program together. Oh God, and we now go into the service. We ask that you just open up our understanding to receive your joy of your salvation. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Songs of Isaiah, written by Adolphus Hailstorp in 1987. There are three movements, and we do the first two, A Voice Says Cry, and Those Who Trust in the Lord. The third movement is entitled, My People Shall Dwell in Tranquil Country. In a tranquil country, we will not be doing that at this time. With piano, our accompanist is Dr. Eric Conway. A work that we will do, if you're in the Philadelphia area, we always tell you where we're going next. We're preparing to do this work in its entirety, it's about 15 minutes, with the Philadelphia Orchestra in its Martin Luther King celebration on Monday evening. Currently we do for you now these two movements to be followed by hymn, O For a Faith. Thank you.
you know, because we've done it for a number of years, this is the time when we announce the annual curriculum award. As you know, the Martin Luther King Committee advertises, asks for secondary teachers throughout the county to compete for these awards. This year we had a fair amount of submissions, and they were judged by a panel of current and tired educators. No, that says retired educators. This year's entry goes to a pair from Biggerville High School, Ms. Beth O'Boyle and Mr. Joseph Yeck. I know Beth is here. Did Joe make it? Wonderful. Good. You got your game rescheduled, I guess. Their entry this year is entitled The Dream of Justice, The Legacy of the Struggle. And on behalf of the Martin Luther King Planning Committee, I'm pleased to award you a community plaque, and even better, a check for $300 to help you with materials for your curriculum at the 11th grade class at Biggerville High School.
Good evening. On March 25th, 1965, Dr. Martin Luther King delivered an empowering speech. It was titled, Our God is Marching On. And he did the speech in three segments. The first one was, We Are Here. The second one was, We Are On the Move. And the third one was, My People Listen. Tonight I'll be reading to you, We Are On the Move. We are on the move now. The burning of our churches will not deter us. We are on the move now. The beating and killing of our clergymen and young people will not divert us. We are on the move now. The arrest of murderers will not discourage us. We are on the move now. Like an idea whose time has come, not even the marching of our mighty armies can halt us. We are on the move to the land of freedom. Let us therefore continue our triumph and march to the realization of the American dream. Let us march on segregated housing until every ghetto of social and economic depression dissolves and Negroes and whites live side by side in decent, safe, and sanitary housing. Let us march on segregated schools until every vestige of segregation and inferior education becomes a thing of the past, and Negroes and whites stay side by side in socially healing context of the classroom. Let us march on poverty. Let us march on poverty until no American parent has to skip a meal so their children may march on poverty. Until no starved man walks the streets of our cities and towns in search of jobs that do not exist. Let us march on ballot boxes. Let us march on ballot boxes until no race baiters disappear from the political arena. Let us march on ballot boxes until the Wallaces of our nation tremble away in silence. Let us march on the ballot boxes until we send to our city council, state legislators, and the United States countrymen, congressmen will not fear to do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with their God. Let us march on ballot box until all over Alabama, God's children will be able to walk the earth in decency and honor. For all of us today, the battle is in our hands. The road ahead is not altogether a smooth one. There are no broad highways to lead us easily and inevitably to quick solutions. We must keep going. Thank you.
Desegregation, and freedom. The human rights that Dr. King and others in the movement so valiantly fought for. However, an often overlooked goal of the civil rights movement was the recognition and public awareness of the contributions made by African Americans and people of color to our nation's success and survival. In fact, many of Dr. King's writings and the writings of others involved in the civil rights movement often referenced men and women of color who made contributions toward the success of our great nation. Men and women who were unfortunately and unfairly excluded from our history books. Over the past decade, there has been an increased effort to recognize the many contributions made by our brothers and sisters of color for the betterment of mankind and the betterment of our nation. This evening, Adams County is very fortunate to have with us an individual who has taken a lead role in such a project. A project that indeed advances the necessary civil rights goal of properly and correctly recording the contributions of African Americans to our nation. Lyndia Grant Briggs serves as the project director for the African American Civil War Memorial Project. As project director, Ms. Grant Briggs also serves as a liaison between the board of directors of the Civil War Memorial Freedom Foundation and numerous private and government agencies involved with the project. She brings to the project many skills and experiences. As a communications major, Lyndia has served as the lead coordinator for many unveiling events. She has worked as an events coordinator for more than 20 years. Her background ranges from experience in the federal government at the United States International Trade Commission, where she prepared tariff schedules used by the President of the United States. She worked as a supervisor recruiter for Children's Hospital Medical Center in Oakland, California, where she was responsible for the supervision of nursing administration. For 10 years, she was the president of her own small family business, Critique Career Management Services, where she and her three sisters served as partners. The corporation was awarded several federal and local government contracts to perform job training for the unemployed citizens under the District of Columbia Department of Employment Services. Ms. Grant Briggs has served as the lead event coordinator for the Bush Quail Inaugural Youth Ball and as an events coordinator for the Clinton Gore Inaugural Committee. In October of 1998, Lyndia was selected as the Outstanding Businesswoman of the Year by the National Association of Business and Professional Women for the Washington metropolitan area. In her role as the project director, she's responsible for writing proposals to foundations, corporations, and other organizations, and serves as a contact person for questions regarding the project. She has charted the progress of more than $3 million in funding required for the project. Ms. Grant Briggs has served as the keynote speaker on the subject of the Civil War Memorial to U.S. Colored Troops all across the nation, from Jackson, Mississippi to Kentucky State University to the U.S. Department of Defense in Staten Island, New York. In July, the unveiling of the Spirit of Freedom Memorial Celebration received 164 national television news stories. Ms. Grant Riggs organized and coordinated more than 200 volunteers to assist with duties required for the groundbreaking promotional celebration in 1996. Most importantly, Lyndia has received verification from approximately 2,000 families of U.S. colored troops as proof that their ancestors did indeed fight in the Civil War. These descendants were located through the outreach of the project director in the form of news release searches. These releases reached African American newspapers in more than 200 cities. After these releases reached the newspapers, calls started pouring in from around the world. Copies of military and pension records came in from the descendants as proof. And finally, rosters of family members were mailed to Ms. Grant Riggs. The final celebration is scheduled for completion in the late summer or early fall of 1999. The monument will be turned over to the National Park Service, bearing the engraved names, and this is a very impressive number, of 209,143 colored troops, including 7,000 of the white officers. On behalf of the Martin Luther King Planning Committee, it is indeed a great honor for me to present Lyndia Grant Riggs. Please join with me in welcoming her with a very warm Adams County welcome.
Taylor Tyree never said anything. She just continued to talk to me. So I said, well, how did you get my name? And she said, it was referred to you by someone from the DC Bar Association. I didn't know the lady. So I just want to say, sometimes when you rise above it all, things happen for you that you don't expect. And it's a pleasure to be here at this 19th annual Martin Luther King celebration in Gettysburg, someplace I never dreamed I'd be. And I'm so happy to see so many wonderful faces here. And in a place where Abraham Lincoln gave the Gettysburg Address, I had to do a little extra research. Said, now we here in Washington have done a monument that is almost complete, maybe 85% complete, to U.S. colored troops who fought in the American Civil War. And most people don't know about it. I heard one speaker say that during the Civil Rights Movement, this part of Black people history was neglected. Why was it neglected? Because it's not being taught in schools. It's not being taught in colleges and universities. When Frank Smith walked up to me and asked me to talk to me about a monument that he wanted to do for the Civil War memorials to U.S. colored troops, I had no clue about what he was talking about. But he had seen me do large projects around the city, and for some reason he was led to talk to me about this, and I said, I'll come and meet with you. And we sat down and we talked, and he was all fired up about it, and I still didn't know the story. So 7 years ago, we sat down and we talked, and I began to hear him say it over and over, and I know our former mayor Barry would say many times that Frank Smith was telling his story instead of history. It was his story for a while, but after a while, instead of it being Frank Smith's his story, it became the history that it really is, because all of us started to understand what it really meant to have a monument to the U.S. colored troops who fought in the Civil War. I learned today while I was here that in the Battle of Gettysburg, the 54th Company B participated. It was on June 30th in 1863 when Abraham Lincoln, when the proclamation, the Emancipation Proclamation was signed on January 1st, 1863. Then on June 30th, the first regiment of U.S. colored troops was mustered into the American Civil War. And that regiment was from Washington, D.C. And when the war was over in 1865, there were 166 regiments of U.S. colored troops that fought in the American Civil War. They fought in Union Army, they fought in cavalry, and they fought in heavy artillery, light artillery. Then we also had hundreds of thousands of contrabandmen who also worked with the Civil War. Their names will never be written in history. Now you want to know, how do we know that it was 235,000 U.S. colored troops? In Washington, when our board of directors decided to do this monument, we wanted to put the names on the memorial. That's the last step that we have to do now. We would beautify a plaza in the Shaw neighborhood, named for Robert Gould Shaw, who headed up the 54th Massachusetts. In the Black neighborhood, now it's mixed, more and more African, more and more whites, and other ethnic groups have moved into the area, and it's a major revitalization effort for that community. And we're pleased that so many groups are coming to visit already the memorial that is not even complete, which tells us all what a great story this must be. We went and we worked untiringly to find funds. We started off with $0. Why are there no national monuments to U.S. colored troops? No national monuments because it's our history. We have to write our own history and let it come out of the books of the National Archives. The National Archives had to dust off records, books that held the names of these 235,000-year-old names of U.S. colored troops, including 7,000 white officers. The names were verified from the records at the National Archives, and the National Park Service sponsored it out of a program project called the Civil War Soldiers and Sailors System. It's a national project that's being done by the National Park Service that will list all of the soldiers who fought in the Civil War, Union, Confederate, Black, and White. So when our chairman, Frank Smith, heard about this, he decided that it would be wonderful if, when the Park Service is putting these names in the computer, that they could verify our names. We want, when people come to see this monument, we want them to know that those names are real, that these men did indeed fight in the Civil War, because so many of us didn't know that. And we don't want to put some names up on a wall that can't be proven. We want people to be able to go to the National Archives, find any name that they see on those records. So we went in and asked the National Park Service if they would agree to enter the names of the U.S. colored troops first, because it's more than 5 million, about 5.3 names that are going into this system. And we knew if they would agree, then we would have an authenticated list of soldiers that would be listed on our walls. They did in fact agree. It's taken a long time. We had to spend several years. The Mormon Church in Salt Lake City, Utah, is responsible for coordinating the computerization of the names. As you all know, that's the largest genealogical database here in this country. They have agreed to coordinate the names of the U.S. colored troops, as well as all of the more than 5 million names of soldiers who fought in the Civil War. It has been completed. We have volunteers in more than 7 states that entered the names into the computer, and I served as a state coordinator in Washington. I don't think I included that on my list, but we had to find volunteers to help enter those names of U.S. colored troops into computer database. Salt Lake City, Utah, verified, re-verified, and made sure that those were correct with their computer systems in conjunction with the National Archives and the National Park Service. So that's how we were able to get the names, and they worked on them for almost 2 years, this whole national project of gathering the names. Meanwhile, we were also working on the monument. We had to find a sculptor to do our monument, and it's called the Spirit of Freedom Memorial. Ed Hamilton is our sculptor out of Louisville, Kentucky, and we're very pleased that the monument has already been unveiled. And if any of you wonder, well, why has the monument been unveiled when it's not complete? None of us knew that it would take so long to finalize the names. The best estimates gave said that the names would be completed in time for our July 18th opening that we just had back in July. We had an opening on July where we unveiled the Spirit of Freedom Memorial, and the plaza was beautiful. National Park Service estimated around 40,000 people attended from all around the country. At Vermont Avenue and U Street, you could see people everywhere. It was just wonderful. And as you all probably know, July 18th is the date of the assault on Fort Wagner, when the U.S. colored troops from the movie Glory, the assault on Fort Wagner, it happened on that day in Fort Sumter, South Carolina. And we're very pleased that one of the Medal of Honor winners that you saw in that movie won a Medal of Honor. And we were pleased that there are 14 Medal of Honor winners who actually fought in the Union Army of the Civil War, 30,000 sailors, and 8 sailors also from the American Civil War received Medals of Honor. Now, Howard University is currently doing the names, entering the names of the sailors. The sailors' names will not be on the walls of the memorial, but we are working on currently a visitor center that's right at the intersection of Vermont Avenue and U Street. We have moved into that location now. So on the walls, you will see 209,143. And if you want to know why it's not 235,000, because it's so many names, there's not enough room to enter. For example, because the soldiers were slaves, I think there were about 900 George Washingtons, men who ran away from their families during the time of slavery. Now, let me just talk about the state of the country during the Civil War. During the Civil War, remember, it started 1861 and it lasted to 1865. U.S. colored troops didn't fight only until 1863 officially. Many of them traveled along with the Civil War as contraband, and they ran away from the plantations because they could not They could not officially fight in the war until the Emancipation Proclamation was signed on January 1st, 1863. Then on June 30th, the first regiment was mustered in, and then they could officially form all of those 166 regiments. I want to go to some of the quotes from the Emancipation Proclamation. When Abraham Lincoln signed, whereas on the 22nd day of September AD 1862, a proclamation was issued by the President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, containing, among other things, the following, to wit, that on the first day of January AD 1863, all persons held as slaves within any state or designated part of a state, the people whereof shall then be in rebellion against the United States, shall be then, thenceforward, and forever free. And the proclamation goes on, and I'm just going to read you the ending. And by virtue of the power and for the purpose aforesaid, I do order and declare that all persons held as slaves within said designated states and parts of states are and henceforth shall be free, and that the executive government of the United States, including the military and naval authorities thereof, will recognize and maintain the freedom of said persons. Now here's the part of the proclamation that I think Dr. Martin Luther King must have focused on. And I hereby enjoin upon the people so declared to be free to abstain from all violence. See, he was about nonviolence. To abstain from all violence is what was written in it, unless in necessary self-defense. And I recommend to them that, in all cases, when allowed, they labor faithfully for reasonable wages. And then this is the last part I want to mention on the proclamation. And I further declare and make known that such persons of suitable condition will be received into the armed services of the United States to garrison forts, positions, stations, and other places, and to man vessels of all sorts in said service. Now, it's unfortunate that this country, a part of our history that we all are not proud of, that is of slavery. And it's also unfortunate that such a proclamation had to be witnessed. We shouldn't even have to do that, but we had to do it here in this America, and the Constitution had to be ratified. So the 13th Amendment of the Constitution was written, and it's the Section 1 said neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States or any place subject to their jurisdiction. This amendment was ratified by Congress, and from the 31st day of January 1865 to December 6, 1865, in 26 of 36 states. There were states that ratified their state constitutions, different dates, and I'm not going to give them to you. But what I am going to tell you is that the amendment was rejected and not ratified by Mississippi. And that in the state of Kentucky, guess when it was ratified? March 18, 1976. 1976. It was never ratified by the state of Mississippi. So now, can't you see why there was so much to do for Dr. Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement down in the South? And don't you remember hearing so much about Mississippi in particular? The civil rights movement was very prevalent in Mississippi. Swerner, James Traney, Swerner, we went down to the graveside. We took a group of students, Frank Smith and I. And those men were killed. I'm sure you probably have seen a movie where they were chased in a town in Mississippi, and they were killed. Mississippi never did ratify the Constitution. When I spoke down at Kentucky State, for the first time in my life, I felt like the descendant of a slave, because I heard the slave stories in Kentucky. And when I heard about them being ratified in 1976, I couldn't believe it. I wanted to go back and see it for myself. So I did see it. And if any of you don't believe me, you go and look, and you'll see March 18, 1976. Now, also 1946, I'm moving down. What I'm doing is talking about the Civil War during, I'm talking about the state of the country during and after the Civil War and the Civil Rights Movement. In 1946, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that desegregation of interstate bus and train travel was unlawful. That was 1946. I just want to mention that, and this has just come to me. My grandfather down in North Carolina, who's deceased, bought 300 acres of land in 1945. Can you imagine? And my family still own that land today. It's in the, you can read about it in the Library of Congress. You know it had to go through a lot in order for him to purchase the land. And when I see that the Supreme Court had to do a ruling of desegregation in 1946, it just makes you remember what the state of the country was like back in those days. And how could he, a black man, not a mulatto, an African-looking short man, my grandfather, was able to purchase the land, maintain the land, and it was written in the Library of Congress that we went to read about that he and his family would keep that land and none of the other families, which I won't name, would ever be able to get that land back. Now they lost that land, it was a white family, of course, and he purchased it at an auction. And so when they found out that a black man had purchased it, you know they didn't want that. No, not a black man, take our land, 300 acres. So that just came to me as I was speaking. I wanted to say that to you. I talked quite a bit about the state of the country and the history of the U.S. colored troops. So I did it from memory. So I'm going to skip part of my speech and I'm going to go to the state of the country during the Civil Rights Movement. Down in the South and during the Civil Rights Movement, it's amazing what Dr. Martin Luther King had to encounter. Dr. King worked, it was back from 1946 when the Constitution was ratified. Why then did Rosa Parks have to move off her seat on the bus? And that was 1956, 10 years later. Brown versus the Board of Education in Topeka, Kansas, that was 1954. There were student sit-ins. Obviously, when the Ku Klux Klan decided that black people might be free, but we'll find a way by hiding under, you know, the hood, we'll find a way to stop some of this movement that's going on. That's the reason that although we were legally free, the Civil Rights Movement had to occur, and Dr. Martin Luther King had to fulfill in his life efforts that we are now enjoying 70 years later. Dr. King was born 70 years ago, and he was born to die helping the Civil Rights Movement. James Meredith, 1961-1962, applied to the University of Mississippi. He was the first black man to attend University of Mississippi. 1961, freedom rides all throughout the South because rules were being ignored for desegregation. We had the Constitution, we had the Emancipation. Why then, after the Supreme Court ruled desegregation is illegal, you remember water fountains for colored only. No, you can't eat in here. You have to get out of here. You cannot eat in this counter. We had Lena Horne, who might be performing, who couldn't go through the front door of a hotel. She had to go through the back door of the hotel. And that's why, because of Dr. Martin Luther King, it's so wonderful to stand here as an African-American woman and see this audience mixed the way it is. Let's give us all a round of applause for coming this far and being here today, living the dream. We're living the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King. 1964, we had Freedom Summer. Nowhere in the country were African Americans so completely removed from the seat of power than in Mississippi. Right back to what I said to you about Mississippi.
so many blacks were hung and killed and were found missing in the state of Mississippi. 1964 to 66 in Selma, Alabama, there was a combination of righteous causes, inspired leadership, courageous followers, and unjust brutality came together once more. And from Selma, Roy Wilkins was the Civil Rights Movement's last great parade. 1965, the Voting Rights Act passed. Remember, black people couldn't vote now. First we were set free, then the Constitution was ratified. We could fight. We still couldn't vote. So 1965, see, a lot of people wonder, why is it that black people haven't progressed much more than they have? If we look back at what has happened over 130 years, and you look at the dates, 1965, Voting Rights Act passed. That's not very many years ago, is it? Not very many years ago at all. 1968 was when it all happened. Racial tension in Memphis simmered just below the surface. It needed only one spark to erupt in violence, and that was provided by a city sanitation worker strike in February. As prolonged negotiations broke toward a settlement that always seemed just out of reach, civil rights leaders took advantage of the opportunity to use movement techniques in an economic problem. Soon the nation found its attention focused on the city mayor, union organizers, preachers, and civil rights leaders of national stature, all embroiled in what would become a tragic course of events led by Reverend Dr. 600 monuments to soldiers who fought in the Civil War. The Spirit of Freedom Memorial is the only monument to the U.S. colored troops who fought in the American Civil War. 166 battles, 68,000 men were killed. African-American men were killed in battles of the Civil War. They fought right here in Gettysburg, Company B. They fought in Richmond. They fought in states all over the country. That's why we have families that are so excited that are pulling out their documentation and records and sending to Ms. Grant. We have copies of things from my grandfather. We have photographs. And they never knew it would mean anything, because they never thought that the U.S. colored troops would be remembered. They remembered it in their own homes and in their own lives. But they were so excited, and I remember the chairman said to me, we probably won't have much activity at the Spirit of Freedom Memorial like the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. It's been over 130 years in a year. We probably won't get much of many visitors. Can you believe that? These people were excited and delighted, and it's just been amazing. In conclusion, let me just say that race is a myth, a fabrication of the human mind. The first fabrication is the idea that any one race is superior to another. All races have their geniuses and their idiots. As with language, no race is superior to another. As sociologist W.I. Thomas observed that, quote, if people define situations as real, they are real in their consequences, end quote. The fact that no race is superior, or that we cannot even decide how people should be biologically classified into races, is not what counts. What makes a difference for social life, rather, is that people believe these ideas, for people act on beliefs, not on facts. It's been a pleasure to speak to you today, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you all will come to Washington anytime to see the Spirit of Freedom Memorial and to see some of the museums, the Visitor Center documents that we're going to have on display, to learn about the 22 Medal of Honor winners, to see the names, although they may be small, on the memorial walls when it's complete, and to appreciate, although it's taken 7 years, I understand it took 40 years for the Roosevelt Memorial. It takes time to build memorials, but at least it's there, and although it's not finished, you know the part that the National Park Service or the National Archives is responsible for will be done. Federal government is responsible for the naming, so you know that's going to be finished, right? They just want to be sure that it's accurate, that it's correct. There will be a statement on the memorial underneath the Spirit of Freedom Memorial that state that these names were authenticated by the archives and the National Park Service. I thank you all for inviting me, and it's been a pleasure to be here today. Thank you very much.
the shadow of your outstretched arm. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
This has been hot, so we'll keep it hot. We were very much impressed, as you were, with the keynote address from Mrs. Lyndia Grant Briggs and the knowledgeable address brought to home places and people that we identify with in this choir. Most of you who followed our visits here have heard me speak about my hometown, Selma. Whenever I hear them in that dress, it sort of conjures up the things that home will conjure up. But I was thinking as she was speaking, when she mentioned other places, that representing the current generation from those places, we have students from Montgomery. Stand up if you're from Montgomery, Alabama. Step out front. I want to see who you are. Come on, quick. Come on out front. How much of it they have experienced, but they read about it and they hear about it. Even when they are from the same place, they don't always know what has taken place. I find that with students who are growing up currently in services of this type, really are beneficial in educating those of us who are coming, those of them who are coming after the fact. And as the people who grow up in districts like Gettysburg, many times you don't see the memorials like the visitors. So maybe you've learned something about your hometown that you didn't know, I'm not certain. Let me see the group from Selma, Alabama. Come on out. Now, if I were to ask you, do you have stories to tell that would relate to what you heard tonight? You heard about them? Is that something burning for you to talk about? No. No burning tale you heard your grandmother or somebody to talk about that would be of interest to all of us? But you don't have to ask your neighbor. I thought you'd have at least one story to tell. Somebody here from Birmingham or nearby Birmingham, Alabama. Stand up, Chris, wherever you are. Yeah, anyway, that is one story that I want to tell. And in addition, now y'all think about it. I'm going to leave you standing out there. If you want to tell me something before I finish this, you can do so. We have, in our travels, often been in performance in Ebenezer Church, as many would visit there. Currently, I have a sister there who's very much involved in the project to build a new church that you all know about that's going to be opened up across the street from the old Ebenezer. It's already, the walls are there, and they will be going into it in March. And I'm saying to you now that this choir is a part of that week-long ceremony, which will take place March 18th or 19th, the Friday before they go into this first service. We will be doing a major concert there, as we've often been involved in the history of that church in our current time. We have with us students who attempted to do music as a major and to do the wonderful work that we saw being led by the director of this youth choir. Let's give them a hand again. And as the choir stands, we are now about to present to you a work that was put together for a ceremony last Sunday evening at the Kennedy Center when the Choral Arts Society there did their 10th annual tribute to Dr. Martin Luther King in a program of music with the visiting choirs like our Morgan State University Choir. And a work that was commissioned on that occasion by the composer Moses, by the Choral Arts, requesting services of Moses Hogan, the wonderful arranger in our current day, did something based on the Negro spiritual with the writings, he being the librettist. And this composition took the title, His Light Still Shines. And we think we'll do that for you at this time with the narrators. Would you step up? Stacey Sator, not necessarily in that order. Shonda Gladden, Lifeview Nicole Pfeiffer to do the third reading. And Kirk Carrington, you'll have a chance to close it out. And each of you will speak from this location, and there will be solos. His Light Still Shines.
Of a future big enough to encompass the dreams and gifts.
darkness was deep. A people who nearly a century earlier had been freed from the shackles of slavery found themselves still bound by a myriad of unjust laws and entrenched social customs. When the most affluent society on earth sat down at the table of plenty, the sons and daughters of Africa assisted with preparing the feast and cleaning up afterward. But they were denied seats at the banquet table. The darkness of despair rolled in like a thick fog, obscuring the path to freedom, justice, and injustice, and onto the simple pathway of peace.
Of his contribution will have been missed. For he came to set us free from the suffocating effects of bigotry and intolerance. America would have little basis for exerting moral leadership in the world if it had not come so far toward the eradication of its own brand of apartheid at home. Still, many battles are yet unwon in the war Dr. King died fighting. Wherever the struggle for justice, equality, and dignity continues to be waged without recourse to bullets and bombs, his light still shines. And those today who take up the challenge of overcoming hatred with love are responding, as Martin Luther King did, to the clarion call of the old spiritual that said, "Hold up your light, you heaven-bound soldier. Let your light shine round the world."
Oh,
children of God say amen.
Amen.
Let the children of God say amen.
Amen.
Let the children of God say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Let us stand together.
Standing, this is an opportunity for all of us to participate singing. If you haven't done so in the first number, do so now. And we have this tradition of our choir joining you there. I want to ask one of our seniors, Rakitha Allen, to join me here, along with Stacia Sator, a couple of them, and they're going to help lead out the verses. Brother Miller, I want you to go over to that mic, and I'll give you a verse too. And choir, would you start moving down that aisle while Dr. Eric Conway starts playing Soften, We Shall Overcome. And we want you to really raise the roof. Alto, you go down the center aisle. We'll put the sopranos down this aisle. Basses, you go down the aisle on your side there. And grab somebody's hands. If you can get in the aisle with them, it'd be very nice. And let's have the sopranos to my right over here. And Alto, you can come too. Find somebody. Meet someone.